We are Catholic Extension, and we have a story to tell. For the next half hour and throughout this series, we'll share inspiring stories, stories of people who are making a difference in our church. For over 100 years, Catholic Extension has worked to build faith, inspire hope, and ignite change in America's most marginalized communities. This episode of Catholic Extension looks at the Catholic Church at the U.S. Mexico border. This is the country's most densely Catholic area, with a growing, young, and vibrant Catholic community. It's a crossroads and the place of an encounter of cultures. It's also a place where many Catholics are poor. The border region is today's Ellis Island, where immigrants, refugees, and asylum seekers who are fleeing violence enter the country and encounter the face of the U.S. Catholic Church for the first time. We will tell you the story of this vibrant Catholic community, which is supported by Catholic Extension, and through its many ministries of mercy and love, is answering the call of the gospel to welcome the stranger. During an historic mass on the Rio Grande in Juarez, Mexico, our Holy Father, Pope Francis, asked us to put a human face on the crisis faced by the immigrants and asylum seekers whose fate is so much in the news today. Our church has embraced its role and its responsibility to welcome and to reach out and minister to our brothers and sisters who are seeking a better life in the face of economic and social injustices, violence, and even the threat of death. After his own pastoral visit to the border, Catholic Extension's Chancellor, Chicago's Archbishop Blaise Supich, spoke with us about the plight of our immigrant brothers and sisters.
The story of our salvation in Jesus begins with the story of refugees. The Holy Family were refugees. It's at the core of who we are. To make sure that those who are on a journey are protected by the church and that we advocate on their behalf. We are a land of immigrants, and they not only want to receive, but they want to give. And we lose something of our heritage, we lose something of our character and our soul when we turn our back on immigrants.
The church's vision and understanding of the immigration of peoples and the kind of response as a human response to human needs and to human situations is going to be an issue that will continue to be at front and center in terms of the life of the Church in the United States.
Our Holy Father, Pope Francis, calls on us to consider this global situation in human terms. The vast majority of these strangers, truly our brothers and sisters, are good people on the move, poor families struggling with poverty, experiencing violence and enduring human rights violations. This speaks to the very heart of our American values as well, of being a haven for your tired, your poor, your huddled masses yearning to breathe free. Chicago's Archbishop Blaise Supich chose the occasion of his elevation to cardinal to raise funds for those providing assistance along the border.
I thought it was a good opportunity to put the spotlight not on me, but on the mission of Catholic Extension and the work that's being done by a lot of good people on the borders.
What I see is the need to respond to the dignity and of the people that we see coming to our border and that need our help. I visited the detention facility when back in 2014 when the children were detained, and when I walked in there, they were all crying, asking me to please help them, to get them out of there. Get me out of here. I can't breathe. I want my mother. It is truly not at all political. It is who we are as human beings.
Hola, chiquita.
When somebody is totally against the idea of helping someone, like in this case, immigrants or the refugees, all they have to do is come and see. And I've had that happen to me before, where a lady comes over and says, "Sister, I'm 100% against what you're doing." And I said, "Let me show you what I do and why." And I have her walk with me through the area and show her the people and see the faces and the families and the children. And then she turns around and tells me, "I'm 100% in favor of what you're doing."
Missionary of Jesus, Sister Norma Pimentel, works to meet the basic humanitarian needs of the large number of migrants who enter the U.S. legally at the border crossing in McAllen, Texas. The people and families that arrive here have been processed at the border and granted temporary legal status. They stay at the respite center for an average of 24 hours before moving on to their intended destinations in the U.S. Cardinal Supich and a delegation from Catholic Extension met with migrants who had just arrived.
I went and talked to each of them about where they came from, who was with them, where they were going, to let them know that the church welcomed them and would be ready to assist them in their own journey. That very human experience stays with me probably the most.
The people that we are actually helping do have temporary legal status. People that are coming to our country are actually turning themselves into the Border Patrol. They are asking for help. They're saying, "Help me, I need protection. My life is not safe in my country." They're from Salvador, Guatemala, and Honduras. Those are the three main countries. Of course, we've seen from almost 30, 40 different countries that have come through our center since we've opened, people from China, from Japan, from Africa, from everywhere have come through our doors. I think that we never should feel that we've done enough, because there's always more to do.
I, Cardinal Blaise Supich of Chicago, humbly present this plaque commemorating a $100,000 gift for the construction of this humanitarian respite center.
I think of my grandparents, who were also immigrants. They were helped by a lot of people to, when they landed in New York, to come across the United States, settling in Omaha, Nebraska. It took a lot of people who volunteered, individuals who made a difference in allowing that to be happen. So this is, in a way, payback.
The reality is that we live on the Rio Grande River in the Diocese of Brownsville are realities that are of families that in many instances have been there for generations, influenced by the culture of Mexico for historical reasons. And yet, currently, we're seeing right now, of course, the phenomenon of immigration. We hear a lot of the negative stuff that happens in some of our poorer communities, especially with the issue of immigration. There's a lot of rhetoric that goes, that kind of misses the point that we're talking about people and that people need to help people and help take care of people. When people have a chance to get together and encounter each other, as the Holy Father says, then the work of grace can bear great fruit.
In the past 5 years alone, Catholic Extension has provided more than $12 million to help build up and strengthen the Catholic community in the U.S.-Mexico border region. Since its founding, donors to Catholic Extension have given $120 million to the dioceses along the border, a place that is home today to more than 4 million Catholics from very diverse backgrounds. Catholic Extension is there to serve them all.
The work of Catholic Extension in helping those dioceses, those local churches, those bishops who live day to day with the experience of immigrants coming into their own diocese and their local church is an opportunity for us to link people throughout this country who don't have that experience. What Catholic Extension is doing is stretching the imagination and the understanding of Catholics who are donating to it to help its wonderful work beyond maybe their own way of thinking. It's an opportunity that we offer to people for conversion of heart, to grow in their faith.
We're living up to the best tradition of what Catholicism has been in the United States, which has been a Catholicism that has been open to the immigrant from wherever they might be coming, whether it's Europe or Asia or the Philippines or Africa. This is really sort of the dynamism of our time, And we have to, as a church, be a people who put always the human face of Christ in front of us first.
The U.S. Catholic Church has a long and proud tradition of being an immigrant church, extending mercy and welcoming the stranger. Support of these ministries is central to the historic role of Catholic Extension in building up the Catholic Church across the United States. St. Mark's Parish in El Paso is a wonderful example of a thriving Catholic community that is recognized and is responding to the many different challenges in this border region.
St. Mark is a great parish. We are blossoming in ministries. We have over 60 ministries. We have a lot of adult formation programs in our parish. Right now, it's the biggest parish in the city. And there's a tremendous hunger now to grow in their Catholic faith. Pope Francis inspired our planning for the future of this parish to see themselves as missionary disciples and not just as people who go to church. So we're dealing with our Catholic identity as well as our credibility in the broader community. And Tepeyac has been able to offer courses to people who could otherwise not afford to take formation. Thanks to the Extension Society, over 30,000 people have been trained in this diocese to become adult ministers. It is one of the largest lay institute in the country. We're talking jail ministry, we're talking bereavement ministry, we're talking colonia ministry with the poor because of the support we've had from Catholic Extension. So the theology is border theology of sorts, and it responds to the border needs. It's been a tremendous blessing for our diocese and for our parishioners. When you hear the stories and you see the journey and the treasures, journey that they've been through, it changes your heart. Ana comes from El Salvador. She was in her home, just like every day. These thugs came in to rob them. Her husband had her baby as she was cleaning the house, and these thugs came in and shot him. And the bullet hit the baby also. Imagine a mother seeing her husband and her baby being shot. And so they said, we're gonna come back for you later. We've got other houses to go. And so she grabs what little she could, and she grabs her two little girls, and she runs out. On her journey here, she had to eat out of trash cans. She had to beg on the street, stuff she never thought she would have to do as a mother. So finally, she makes it to the border, and we were able to bring her here to the parish. Her kids had not eaten, so the kids had a hard time swallowing the food at first. But we had medical help here. And by the next day, with some medication, the kids were able to eat. And she rested for the first time. She was able to sleep. And that morning, she came to Mass with a tremendous sense of hope. Santa Maria, Madre de Dios, ruega por nosotros. These are stories we hear every day. And I think if the anti-immigrant communities in our nation were to hear the stories of our brothers and sisters who daily struggle to survive, their hearts would be in a different place. The church has to stand in support of welcoming the stranger. It's a gospel mandate that for us also means that you give deeper love that gets translated into some political action that benefits everyone. We need just immigration reform in our country. There's more good in us than bad. And when we treat each other with respect and dignity, humanity gets better.
At the U.S. border with Mexico, the heavy toll on children and families is especially troubling. Catholic missionaries are answering the call of our faith by responding to people and to families who are struggling to find a safe place.
Everyone, because they're created in the face of God, has certain basic rights, and the rest of us that are not in a situation of forced migration have a responsibility to live out Matthew 25. If we live that out, there will be no problem with forced migration because everyone will have a place where they will be welcome. Annunciation House is an organization that offers hospitality to refugees and immigrants. We're only literally 10 blocks from the border, and we've seen literally hundreds of thousands of people pass through our houses across the years. We have a mural that was painted by one of our volunteers with the help of some of the guests, and it's the Spanish version of Matthew 25. You know, tuve hambre y ustedes me dieron de comer. I was hungry and you gave me to eat. Fui extranjero y me recibieron. I was a stranger and you welcomed me. This is the backdrop for our dining room, where three times a day, everybody that's in the house comes up and sits down around the tables to have the meal and break bread. For many of these refugees and immigrants, Pope Francis is a fundamental source of hope. I think that refugees and immigrants are very realistic about how difficult and how unwanted they are in so many places. I think they're very aware of how they get blamed for so much, much of which is not true. And in Pope Francis, they see someone who knows, you know the truth, you know my truth.
No más muerte ni explotación. Siempre hay tiempo de cambiar. Siempre hay una salida. Siempre hay una oportunidad. Siempre hay tiempo de implorar la misericordia del Padre.
It was the most traumatic experience that we live in Chaparral. Because that day, the sheriff department of Otero, they began to visit and entering in the houses, asking for documents and deporting families. And little by little, 28 kids, they were alone in this community with no dad or mom, and the families were broken.
These children are really, we're in danger. That's why we have to change the immigration laws. They destroy families.
I grew up here in Chaparral, New Mexico, from ever since I was born. I don't really remember when the sisters came to town, but I remember feeling that they came to town because everything changed. I always tell my friends that I grew up being raised by my parents and by nuns because my parents are really involved in church. Yeah. So we got really involved with Sister Chavela and Sister and everybody here. And it was like an extended family here.
And now it's so beautiful to see that most of the kids that really graduate from high school, many, many of them are going to college. The desire for us was very clear, to learn and to accompany people and to be witness of the strength of the people and the ability to really support each other. We learn.
We think that we're going to give them something, but we receive much more from them. We are trying to do what Pope Francis wants us to do, to really be there, the church, welcoming the stranger and welcoming those who are in need. So it's a grace for us. We're very happy to be here at the border.
Okay. A sense of belonging and hope for the future are basic human needs, especially for young people. This holds true for a group of young adults, people who were brought to the United States as undocumented infants and children, the Dreamers, those affected by Deferred Action for Childhood Arrivals legislation. After growing up American here, Dreamers are faced with the harshest of uncertainties in the only home they've ever known.
So I've been here since I was 5 years old. This is my home. This is all I have known. For most people, I'm not considered a citizen here, and I'm not considered a citizen in Mexico either, since I didn't live in Mexico for a long period of time. So I'm in between. I don't know what I am.
When I realized that I was going to sign some papers with my mom, it's that I was illegal in the U.S. That totally changed my life.
We just can't lose our fate right now. It's really powerful for me, for everyone to stay with us and just pray with us at this moment.
My dream is to become a pediatrician, to work with those kids that really need that help. Going into a university, it makes me feel like, yes, you know, like I got accepted. You know, I had the opportunity to go. I will never, ever be afraid, you know, to be there with them. I know that my community will always be with me, my family, you know, the people that I work with here at the parish. I know they will always be with me, especially the priest. Pray for me. You know, I don't know what's going to happen in the future, but, you know, it's better for me to know that you guys are with me as well as brothers and sisters.
We went to Washington giving a message saying that we want a clean Dream Act, saying that we're no criminals, we don't harm anybody, and we told them, hear me and listen to what we have to say, because we're young leaders and we're making a change, and God has our back, and just knowing that other churches have our back is just something really powerful. And, you know, we thank everybody that supports us.
And I would prefer for them to come and see and sit with us and talk to us, and they're gonna change their mindset.
The Catholic message of hope and our shared mission of welcoming the stranger was front and center when U.S. and Mexican bishops recently celebrated the Eucharist together at the border.
Well, we're gathering literally on the border in order to celebrate a Mass. It will be a time in which we pray for those who have died crossing this river, crossing through our desert in this part of the country. We've also come to celebrate the unity that we share across the border. So many people today seem to think about a border as a place of confrontation, a place of violence. And that is not our experience here, we who live on the border. This is a place of encounter. And so we're celebrating the greatest sign of unity at a place that really should signify our call to be united across whatever kind of things divide us. We hope that we can show a different possibility, and that we are one body, united in Christ, called to be a family of God. We say those words, they trip off our tongue, but so often we fail to think of the implications of that. A political border has a usefulness, but it should not separate us.
The role that we play today, supporting ministries at the border and building and strengthening vibrant Catholic communities, is as important today as it was when the great numbers of Irish, Italian, German, and other European Catholics arrived on these shores.
We are making sure that we're paying attention to the real-life situation of people. Catholic Extension has always done that from the first days. It's been motivated by a desire to make sure that we really look at those who are neglected the most, and that we bring them into the fold, we give them a place at the table of life.
Kula Pasada. My name is Kasana Tamir Shre.
My name is George. I am from Guatemala.
My name is Mario Garcia, and I'm from Mexico.
I'm Yasmichelle Hernandez. I'm from Cuba.
My name is Marjorie. I am from Honduras.
My name is Sarah. I am from Honduras.
My name is Joanny, and I am from America.
You are an American.
Bless America, and God bless you, is one of us here this afternoon.
It was the late New York Jewish mayor, Ed Koch, who said that there were two women welcoming immigrants to New York, Lady Liberty and Mother Church. The church is mission. Our Holy Father, Pope Francis, calls us to reach out to the marginalized on the peripheries of our society. And he's inviting us to welcome the stranger, to realize our baptismal call by becoming missionary disciples and followers of the risen Christ. I hope you've been inspired by the people and the places we've shown you today. I pray that these stories will move you to follow the call of our faith, to reach out to those in need, and to share the joy of Christ's love. What an exciting time to be Catholic in our country. Please visit our website or call us to join Catholic Extension in our mission of building faith, inspiring hope, and igniting change in mission dioceses across the United States. I look forward to the next time we meet here on Catholic Extension. May God bless you and all whom you love.